Today is a special day, I guess, for the youth. If you looked around, a lot of youth have shirts like this, and on the back it says, "How can I serve you?" We've had students serve as ushers in both morning and this service, also helping with breakfast in the morning, also at the nursing home, singing, and Charlie speaking to them, and then Anderson speaking to Mr. Mike's class upstairs to the middle schoolers. So a lot have stepped out of their comfort zone to do a lot of things, and it's awesome to see. Just so I don't forget, because my mind goes 1,000 different places, I don't know if you guys know or not, Joe Murray passed away, I believe, yesterday or the day before that. So just be with the Landing family and the Murray family as they're dealing with that and all that. Jim Ferrari was doing better. He's kind of taking a relapse. Had some chest pains this morning. And I talked to Paula on Thursday or Friday, and she said they were going to try to come today. And so I guess it happened this morning. And Clyde Isrig and Diane Isrig. Diane had some complications yesterday when she woke up from a nap. We got some news today. She's doing better. So let's pray. So I'm just going to say a prayer for those three and their families, and then we'll dig into God's Word. Father God, you're good to us. Just thank you for everybody here. Lord, we just want to lift up the Murray and the Lanning family as they're dealing with the loss, but knowing that Joe's with you, with his Creator, God, and the life he lived, pouring into people's lives, and to show Jesus' love to them. We lift up the Isrig family as they're dealing with a lot of stuff that nobody wants to deal with. Lord, we are Jehovah Rapha. You are healer of all. You can do anything with a blink of eye, a snap of a finger, Lord. So we just pray, if it is your will, that you do what you do best. And we pray for the Ferraris. As Jim has been struggling this past month, and the strain it could be on Paul and that family, and then it says looking like it's getting better, and they're able to come worship with their church family and woke up with some chest pains. Lord, we just pray that that's all it is chest pains and nothing serious. Put your hands on them in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so I'm going to tell a story. I've told some before, so if you've heard it, please just listen again before we get started. But Corley and I, we're having a Super Bowl party at our house, and I don't know if you guys know, but I'll leave you on a secret. I'm really frugal. In Corley's words, I'm cheap. In the youth's words, I'm really cheap. So we're going to Schnucks, and we're debating back and forth on what we're going to get. And I'm all for, like, the 75 soda that no matter what flavor y'all, it all tastes the same. I'm cool with that. I'm okay with that. If you can spend 5 cents more and get the name brand, she's for that. I think it's 5 cents I could save. So we're battling. She won. So we're going through the aisles getting the sodas and all meatballs and all this stuff. And as we're walking, this lady is just like looking at me. And I'm like, "Corley, do you see this lady just staring at me?" And she says it's because I'm growing my beard out that she's looking at me and it doesn't look good. And it's my midlife crisis and all this stuff. So we're just ignoring her. And we keep walking. Every aisle, she's just there just like looking. And so me, I'm really shy. So I looked at her, and I'm like, "Can I help you?" And Corley smacked me for being rude, and I just wonder why this woman was looking at me. And she just, "You look like my son." And so I was like, "Oh, awesome, cool." And so that was it. We go back, and we get to go check out, and she's there in the same aisle. I'm trying to, like, let's go do, like, the self-checkout or something. Corley's like, "No." So we sit by this lady, and she just keeps staring. And so I'm talking to her. She's like, "I just haven't got to see my son in a long time. And you just look just like him." She showed a picture, and I didn't think it looked like me, but she thinks it did. So anyway, she goes, "Well, I haven't had to hug him in a long time." And so do you... It's not funny. It's weird, okay? So she's like, "Can I hug you?" And I'm like, Corley's like, "Yeah, he'll do it." And I'm telling you, it's not funny, it's weird, okay? So don't do that if you ever see somebody that looks like your kid. But anyway, she's like, "Will you say hey and bye mom to me just so I can feel like I'm holding my son again?" And so Corley's like, "He'll do it." So I hug her. She says, "Bye son." I say, "Bye mom." All that happened. So we're checking out, and my bill comes up to $200. and all I have is $50 worth of stuff. I look at the cash register guy, and I said, it's not possible. He said, your mom said you were paying for it. That's not funny. And so I was like, that's not my mom. And he said, you just... No. And he said, well, you hugged her and said, bye, mom. And I said, I told him the whole story. So we're running out of shook. And she's over by the Chinese buffet throwing her stuff in the car. And I'm screaming and screaming. And when I get there, she's jumping in the car. And I grab her leg and I'm pulling on it like I'm pulling on yours. That didn't happen. But, okay. But look, so I need to repent a little bit. I just lied from the pulpit. So, but... It ties into my message, so just pay attention with me. All right, so how many people thought I was telling the truth? Be honest. A good amount. How many did not believe me? How many people just did not know? A little bit? Okay. All right, so inside, I knew the truth. Outside, I was trying to pursue you, or trying to tell you and get you bought into a story. But inside I knew the truth the whole long. And so the title of this is Secret. And so I want to ask you guys a question, and it shouldn't be a secret, but what we're about to talk about in your personal life, is it a secret? And you're like, what is he talking about? And we're going to talk about your relationship with Jesus. Is it a secret, or can people see it? And that's the same thing as inside. I knew it wasn't true, but I hang out and being fake outside. And so we see two different things. We see a believer that walks, what do I mean to say a believer? We see a person that walks and lives a life for Jesus, but inside does not know him. Or we have a person who inside claims to know Jesus, knows Jesus, but on some days of the week when they're hanging out with certain people in their family or their friends, they act like they don't know him. So is it a secret? And so we'll dig into God's word. I'm going to pray for us. Father God, you're good to us. God, you are an awesome, awesome God. I want to thank you for your grace, your mercy, Lord. Thank you for everybody in this room. Thank you for just your word. Thank you for times where we come together and worship freely without worries. And how you've blessed us with that. And Lord, I pray that what we talk about for the next few moments is convict, encourage, going to guide us and challenge us to be faithful to you like you're faithful to us. If everybody in this room right now that no happen, kick them out the door. That we can focus on your words, not who's speaking, nothing that has happened today, but your word only. And how it can help us, how it can encourage us, how it can change us. Father God, I love you in Jesus' name. Amen. So think about this. Things Christians hide from others. And I give you, if you want to throw some stuff out, you're more than welcome to. I came up with just a few. Things Christians hide from others is that we pray. They go to church and that they have a relationship with Jesus. We hide those things in a whole. Individually, you might not. If I ask you, do you personally hide any of these things from people? Are you embarrassed of any of these things? Do you want somebody in your family, somebody you work with, somebody you come in contact with to know that you pray? Are you afraid for them to know that? Are you afraid for them to know that you go to church? Are you afraid for them to know that you have a relationship with Jesus? An automatic answer, when I asked myself the same question this week, I would say no. But then the Lord kept playing back and tugging at my heart. But every time I do something that is displeasing to God, to a public eye, and if it challenges somebody to question my integrity or challenges somebody to question my relationship with Jesus, I'm hiding these things. And and when I was saved at 18 years old, about 18 or 19, I was playing basketball, pickup game, some stuff happened. And I think I shared this a couple weeks ago and I did something. I don't remember exactly what I did, but somebody looked at me and said, oh, you're supposed to be a Christian? That killed me. It hurts me still to think about it. That I can do can keep somebody away from knowing the truth. Something that I do can keep somebody away from Jesus. Because they look at us, and I didn't say this in the first service, but being a Christian is hard in this part, is if we mess up one time, that's all they remember. Doesn't matter how many good things we do for people, but we mess up one time, that's all they're going to remember, and that's what they're going to label us as. One person that has a platform to share the gospel messes up one time, it's all over social media. And so it's hard. And so I'm going to read, we're going to be in Matthew chapter 10, so if you have your Bible, smartphone, smart anything, your brain, just follow with me. And I'm going to read it a few times. It says, verse 32 to 33, says, therefore everyone who confesses me before men, I will also confess him before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny him before my Father who is in heaven. Read it one more time. Therefore everyone who confesses me before men, I will also confess him before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny him before my Father who is in heaven. I want to look at that highlighted part, whoever denies me before men. Look at it in any context you want. When your life, and when people can look at you and say, look, I don't see Jesus at all, you're denying him. If you claim one time, any time, that you're a born-again believer saved by the blood of Jesus, and somebody can look at your life, or you can look at your life yourself and say, look, that person's not living for Jesus, then you're denying him in that moment, or that situation, or that time. I've been there. I'm not up here to say, look, this is how you do it, and this is what we got to do it. I'm up here talking that I struggle with this too. I love how every time I get the opportunity to speak in the youth or up here, I pray, God, what do I need to learn? And he places it clear. And I struggle with this. There's times where, and it probably will in the future, that I go and I do things the way I drive. If I cut somebody off and they give me the middle finger, I don't give it back. I ain't gonna say that, but you know sometimes you just want to. Moments like that, road rage, the way we talk to people, when we're grumpy, all those things, they remember that one moment. And so whoever denies me before men, I will also deny him for heaven. But do you do this? How many times a week do you do this? Challenge yourself. Ask yourself this. How many times can you look back in this past week and say, look, how many times have I done something that somebody that doesn't know me, that doesn't know that I walk with Jesus every day, they looked at me at this situation and said, man, what is that person's problem? There's no way that that person follows after Jesus. We've been there. We've done that. It's going to happen. If it hadn't happened this week, it's going to happen. It happens to all of us. And so we're going to jump to 34 and 36. It says, do not think that I came to bring peace on earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I came to set a man against his father and a daughter against her mother and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's enemies will be the members of his household. Read that highlighted part with me. Do not think that I came to bring peace on the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. When I ask you, and this is where you guys participate, the early service just looked at me. I had to ask them like four times. When I say the word Jesus, what comes to your mind? Savior. Throw it out. Cross. Just keep going. Give me a few more. God. Holy. Lord. Who thinks peace? That Jesus brings peace to us. Right? He's called Prince of Peace. But the scripture makes me think, do not think that I came to bring peace on earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. So I did some studying, read some commentaries, and the peace that he's talking about is worldly peace. We, as a culture today, more than ever, want to live life for us. You look at what's on the news, look at everything. We want to live a life that glorifies ourselves. We want to do things that stand out to others. We're far from what Scripture says. And so he's saying, look, I didn't come to bring you peace so you could do all these things. And this is last Saturday, not yesterday, but last Saturday, I was playing basketball at New Haven. And Eric Steinbeck was on the other team, and he tried to block my shot and almost hit me in the face. And I walked by and said, man, that was really close. I saw like my whole life flash from my face. And he looked at somebody and said, is it okay to punch the youth guy in the face? And one of the 19, 20-year-old guys, and I'm not trying to offend anybody. I don't know much about the Catholic religion. But what he said just said kind of broke my heart a little bit. And his answer back to Eric was, it's okay to punch him as long as you say some cuss words in the way and then go to confession afterwards. And my thought on that, and that whole night, that's all I kept thinking about. And then knowing I was talking about this, just kind of went into it. If Christ came to bring us peace, worldly peace, we could do whatever the heck we wanted, when we wanted, and just mention it on a Saturday that it's okay. Anything. But as a believer, we do things and we're convicted about it. And because he died and bled a death that none of us can imagine, I'm able to say sorry and be forgiven. Now look at the two differences. Is I want to do these things and I know it will be okay. Romans 6:1 says, should I sin so may grace be may abound? Should I sin because I know that I'm going to have grace? That is the method that that young man was talking about. It's okay as long as I do these things because I know that I'm going to say I'm sorry. So it's okay. But no, as believers, it's the opposite. We're trying to avoid these situations and we know we're going to mess up and we're sorry about it. We don't want to. It's just our human nature. We do it. We're attracted to dirty things. We're attracted to sin. Sin is fun. Sin is beautiful in our eyes. And that's why Jesus came. And then Jesus is talking about the sword of spirit. In Ephesians 6:17, we'll see this as Jesus talking about the sword of spirit. He came to pierce that peace, that worldly peace. So we have that desire to do these things, but because he came and he conquered it, we don't want to anymore, if that makes any sense. Because I know when I was from 13 to 17 years old, I was not saved before 13, but that's when life really hit me. I did a lot of stupid things. A lot of stupid, stupid things. That was fun. That hurt a lot of people's feelings. That made my friends laugh when I did it. And I wasn't sorry about it. Remember, the moment I got saved, I walked up to two people crying my eyes out and apologizing to them for the things I did. Because at that moment, I was convicted. I didn't want to do these things anymore. And occasionally, I still did, but it hurt. It broke my heart because he brought that sword of spirit into my life. And look at verse 35 with me. For I came to set a man against his father and daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and man's enemies will be the members of his household. All right, we're going to call her Sorry, because I don't know how to say it. If anybody can go with that, we'll call her something else. So, I read a book about a year ago that I think I gave Charlie and never got back. Stuck it out there. Hopefully he's reading. If he's reading it, it's all good. But it was a Francis Chan book, I believe. And this girl told her story. And I want you guys to, I'm going to read her story to you, and I want you to really, really listen. Because it's convicting, it's challenging. This is a 12-year-old girl that dealt with stuff that we'll never imagine. That we'll most likely never have to face in our life. And I hope it challenges you. So a 12-year-old girl in India shared this harrowing account of how her Hindu family beat her and kicked her out of her house after she converted to Christianity. Yet she refused to deny Jesus Christ. I was bullied at school for being deaf, she said. They scold me. You're deaf. It made me so sad. We went to the hospital, to Hindu temples, and even people who practice witchcraft. Nothing helped. One of Sari's aunts, a devout Christian, convinced the 11-year-old to go with her to church. Your family members are not believers in the true God, she told her niece, but I am. Come with me. My God will heal you. She recalled the first time she ever set foot in church. The people were singing songs, and the preacher taught from the Word of God. I heard a little bit of sound, so I could understand a little of what was being said. said and sung. The songs made me happy. After the sermon, the pastor and a few other people prayed for the young girl. What happened next was nothing short of a miracle. They called her up front, and she was able to hear. She was excited about her newfound faith. She came to know Jesus after she was healed. Sari continued to attend the church without telling her family. However, it was long before her brother discovered her secret. He and my father beat me, dragged me into the house. Sari said, one time I was carrying a Bible. He took it, he threw it into the mud and beat me with a stick. Later, I collected the Bible, wiped it clean, and gave it to another believer. He kept it safe for me. Almost every time I went to church, my brother and father beat me. She continued, about 3 months ago, they were fed up with me. My brother and father yelled, if you continue to go to church, we will punish you. They beat and kicked me badly. Then they gave me some clothes and pushed me out the door. My father said, you are not our daughter anymore. But I still went. Oh, sorry. Switch pages on me. All right, so she left the house desperate. Sari fled to a relative's house, walking 6 miles in search of safety. However, her mother found the young girl and brought her home, where she was once again beaten by her 22-year-old brother. Leaving Jesus Christ, he screamed, beating her. Leave Jesus Christ. He kept beating her with a stick and slapping her with his shoes. But Sari refused, stating, I won't leave Jesus. Fearing for her life, she fled to her aunt's, where she had been living with her for the last few months. Now 12 years old, Sari misses her family and attending school, especially now that she can hear because of her persecution. I cannot go to school. I also miss my family a lot. I love my family, but they don't accept me, she said. I've seen them twice after they kicked me out. I don't want to see them. I went to see them, but my father doesn't talk to me. My mother talks a little bit with me, but other than that, my older sister talks nicely. I didn't see my brother. Still, she told Francis Tan that she finds encouragement from God's promises in Scripture. God has said that He will never leave nor forsake us, she said. He is our healer. I think about the fellowship we have on Sundays whenever I feel depressed. I think about fellowship, she added. A believer sister told me, don't leave Jesus Christ. We are here. She encouraged me from the Word of God and strengthened me. India ranks as the 10 worst nation in the world when it comes to Christian persecution. That breaks my heart. Think about this, is a 12-year-old girl comes to know Jesus, is beaten, and every single hit, leave Jesus. And she said, no, He's my everything. I won't. We live in a country where it's freely. We can worship here and not worry about anything. Worry about who's watching. And we still shy away from knowing Jesus. For what reason? At what cost? Matthew 10:37-39 says, he who loves his father more than me is not worthy of me. And he who loves his son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he said, and he who does not take his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. He who has found his life will lose it. And he who has lost his life for my sake will find it. Sari didn't love her father or mother more than her relationship with Jesus. She picked up her cross and said, let's do this. I'm following you, Jesus, no matter what. Wherever you go, I'm there. Let's do it. She was bought in. She realized that he changed her life. She realized that she can't live without Jesus. People were probably telling her, well, look, Jesus isn't here to protect. And I can only imagine in her life, at 12 years old, facing all that stuff and standing firm, I will not. He's my Savior. He's everything I need. Imagine, I ask you guys this question, we'll start off really, really mild. You're 12 years old, and your parents look at you. You're not allowed to go to church. You're not allowed to love Jesus. You're not allowed to say Jesus. What do you do? At 12 years old, I'm probably saying, yes, ma'am, no, sir, or yes, sir, and I'm done. Now let's boost it up a little bit more. You're at your current age now. and you're captured, you're beaten, and they ask you, do you love Jesus? What do you say? It's easy to, and right now the thought comes and you say, oh, I'd say yes, absolutely. Until you're in that situation, you don't know. I pray with bold, bold faith that if I ever get in that situation, I would say, yeah, absolutely, I do. For many reasons. For one, Jesus came. He died on the cross for me. He did nothing wrong. I do a lot wrong. He came. Every blood that dripped from his body on that cross was for us. And a lot of people walk this earth, live their whole life, never come to know him. Then there's a lot of people that come to know him. They're born again believers. And they don't forget about him, but they continue to let people impact their lives more than letting him impact their lives. And so are you at the point of where you're saying, look, Jesus, let's do this. I'm following you wherever you go. Is it worth losing your life so that you can live for Jesus? Romans 3:16 says, I am unashamed of the gospel. I am unashamed of the gospel. Are you unashamed of the gospel? Does your life right now show a picture of being unashamed that you love Jesus? When you leave these doors, do you live a whole different lifestyle than what you do and what you act like in here? Many people who profess to be Christians are denying Christ daily. The main reason for the denial is that people would rather cherish their life here on earth more than life with Jesus. Think about this. I was told, I think David Stallman told me this, and it really was a good point, is the moment you come to know Jesus and you accept him into your life, your old self dies. You have to get to a point where you want your real self to die. Because nobody in here, no matter how good of a person you are, how great of a person you are, can continue to live the same lifestyle you live and then come to know Jesus. Because if you could, there'd be no reason for him. The moment you come to know Jesus, it's a whole different lifestyle. Scripture says the old is gone, the new is come. And so, would you rather cherish your life here on earth more than life with Jesus? There's a lot of people. 1 Timothy 5:8 says, but if anyone does not provide for his own and especially for those of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Look at that highlighted part. He has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. I mean, Scripture, this is crazy. Like, think about this. Scripture's telling us if we deny our faith, if we live a life, we're a born-again believer, if we claim to have Jesus as a personal Savior, and we deny our faith by the way we live, by the way we act, the way we raise our family, all those things, then we're worse than an unbeliever. Unbelievers, we're worse than them. So he's speaking truth. He's speaking stuff that nobody wants to hear. I don't even want to say it. Because two things. He has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. And if you deny him, he's going to deny us in front of our Father, for in front of his Father. And so challenge yourself. Does your life deny your faith? Can people see Jesus when they see you? And does the way you live your life challenge people to know the Lord, or does it cause them to run from the Lord? I want you to focus on that last one. Does the way you live your life challenge people to know the Lord? Can somebody look at your life right now in this past week? Today, we'll go today, and just see Jesus pouring out of you. The way you talk, the way you act, the way we pray. How do we handle things when things are not going our way? Are we strong enough to own up to these things that challenge us, that are hurting our walk? So does the way you live your life challenge people to know the Lord? Or maybe you're on the other end. Does it cause them to run from the Lord? Does the way you live your life cause people to look at you and say, look, I want nothing to do with whatever you got going on? I know last week you talked about having that relationship with Jesus, but I see what you do when you're not in church. Why would I want that? I want the total opposite of that. Because the Bible that I read, or the Bible that people, the Jesus that talks about, those people don't do those things. So why would I want any of that? And this is sad and it breaks my heart, but Christians are labeled as fake. We're labeled as fake. We do it to ourselves as a whole. I'm not pointing anybody out, but we've all been in that place where we can help that case. We say one thing but do the other. And so does your life cause people to run away? I have some friends that don't know the Lord, don't love the Lord, don't want to live for the Lord, rather live in the world, do what the world says is fun, do what the world says is right. And for a while, when we first started hanging out, I'd get to a point where I would do things that I don't do. I wouldn't do it, but I would be around them while they did it, hopefully being like, look, well, if Nathan doesn't do it, maybe we shouldn't do these things either. That didn't work. So I had to ask them, say, hey, can you avoid doing these things while I'm here? Because that's just not who I am, not what I do. And I don't want to get to a point where I stumble and I go against my convictions. And they honored it. But for a while, I was persecuted by it, made fun of. Even though we're still friends, I could handle it. But they would stop inviting me to places because this stuff was more important than our friendship. I shared with the first service, Corley and I are extremely blessed that we waited till marriage. Extremely blessed. My friends have not and continue to not. And I was made fun of for a long time for it. Judged. Because I wanted to wait. Because I feel like that's what God calls us to do. And was made fun of, judged, not invited to things because that was their implant, their end goal. And as a believer, my mindset should be, well, you know what? I don't need to be there anyway, but it still hurts. I'm not like sorry or however you say, it's weird saying sorry, but however you say your name, where I'm getting beaten for being a Christian. And I'm upset because I'm not invited to something that I probably would have said no to anyway. We've all been there. My point is, are you bold enough as a 12-year-old in a different country full of different religion to stand firm for the one who died for you? In a few moments, when we do the invitation, I want to encourage you to be obedient. Part of standing firm and not denying Christ is if he's calling you to come to the altar for any reason, to pray, to talk, if you sit there because you're embarrassed or whatever it is, you're denying him with your life. You're looking at him and saying, look, my moment's my moment, not yours. If I remember when I was 12 years old, a buddy of mine wanted to go walk down the altar, and I didn't want to go with him, so he didn't. Honestly, I don't know if he's saved or not, or we don't communicate anymore, but just the thought that if I would have went walked with him, he might have a relationship with Jesus. Maybe he did, maybe he doesn't, I'm not sure. But I encourage the person next to you, if somebody wants you to come with them, go with them. Bible says that when somebody gets saved, the heavens rejoice. I remember at camp, Danny got saved, and I walked him around to everybody's room saying, look, Danny got saved, even people I didn't even know. I was happy for him. We were all crying, hugging, having a party. And I could just imagine heaven was doing the same thing. And the importance of not denying Christ in this moment. Everybody has a moment where God tugs on their heart. Statistics say there's one person in here that doesn't know Jesus is their personal Lord and Savior. One person at least. Don't be scared that people are going to look at you. Maybe you're one person that like, well, they thought I was saved, so you don't want to get up. Who cares? We're going to rejoice. Because you are now. Be bold. Be firm in your faith. Because again, we saw that scripture where it says, if you're embarrassed of your faith, you're worse than an unbeliever. If you shy away from your faith, you're worse than an unbeliever. That's convicting to me. I challenge you guys and I challenge myself that as we walk around home, wherever home is, Washington, New Haven, Herman, wherever, that you're a walking billboard for Jesus. That people can see Jesus pouring out of you. They're able to look at you and go, that person loves Jesus, or that person is something special. I need to know what they ate for breakfast. And you said, you know what? I didn't eat nothing for breakfast, but I know somebody that can fix you. And so I just want to challenge you guys as I ask the praise team to come up. Does the way you live your life challenge people to know the Lord, or does it cause them to run from the Lord? Don't deny Jesus with the way you live your life. If you're a born-again believer, be proud of it. Us as a church can change the world. I tell the youth, you alone can change the world. They probably look at me like I'm crazy. But it takes one person to talk to one person to where they talk to one person. Then we got a whole bunch of Jesus freaks up in here. So I challenge you guys, don't shy away from it when you're at work, while you're driving, wherever. Be bold for Jesus. Tell people about Jesus. It'd be awesome. When people come into New Haven and they describe it in different ways. I've heard a lot of things. But how awesome would it be if people came into New Haven, came into Washington, came into Herman, whatever area, and said, man, that is a whole bunch of Jesus-loving people. I want to move there. I want to be a part of Memorial Baptist Church. They're doing something special. There are a bunch of people that love Jesus. And so I just encourage you to live a life that glorifies God. Live a life that challenges people to know Him. Live a life that where people want to come to see Him. They want to know what is so special about having a relationship with Jesus. Lecrae, a Christian artist, hip-hop artist, I shared this a couple weeks, but I think it's important to know. He says that if I live my life living for Jesus, and I'm wrong, I lived a good life. But if I live a life glorifying myself, living the world where the world wants me to, and I die, and we find out that Christianity is real and that Jesus did die for us, I've wasted my eternity. Think about that. Be proud that you are a believer. Be proud that you love Jesus. Be proud that He saved you. Because when He was on that cross, He died a death that nobody can imagine and nobody would want to put their kid in or put a relative to do for other people. And every blood that dripped, every last breath had all of our names on it. Are you going to take it and let it change your life? Or are you going to look at it and say, that's nothing. That's nothing for me. Because one day you're going to stay in front of God and He's going to look at you and say, depart from me. I never knew you. Or He's going to say, welcome home, my good and faithful servant. And so as I pray, I encourage you, if God's tugging on your heart for any reason, you don't know the Lord, you're living a life that is displeasing to God, but you do know the Lord or whatever it is, I encourage you to be bold. Who cares what the person to your left, the right, in front of you, behind you, down the hall, cares that you're walking up? Because heaven's rejoicing. And Jesus is smiling. And so as I pray, I encourage you guys. Father God, you're good to us. Father God, you are an awesome, awesome God. Thank you for your grace, your mercy, Lord. You do things that we can't imagine. Changing me, changing people in this room from a life that we deserve to a life we don't deserve. God, you're so gracious. I just want to thank you for your love that you show us, how you're there when sometimes we don't see you. Sometimes we question you if you're really there, but God, you show us in crazy ways. It might not be our timing, but your timing is perfect. But Father God, I pray for everybody in this room right now that there is somebody, at least one person, that doesn't know you as a personal Lord and Savior. God, touch them. Everybody that passes away thinks they have one more second, one more minute, one more day. Father God, we don't know when that time is. You're going to take us home. You're going to take us away from this earth. But God, I pray that you give that one person that's in this room, and if they are in this room, a time to walk down and get it right with you. God, if there's anybody in this room right now that lives a life for you, but is just falling away, is not understanding, is struggling, and it just needs help, I pray they're bold enough to say, look, I love you, Lord, but I need you right now, and I need help. God, you're good to us. Continue to walk with us. Continue to lead us to places that only you can lead us. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you'd like to find out more information or keep up to date on what's happening here at Memorial Baptist Church, you can visit us at our website, www.mbcnewhaven.com, where you can find our weekly bulletin, our church calendar, and also previous sermons. You can also find us on Facebook, YouTube, and also our Church Link app. All that information is on our website, so come on by, check it out, and thank you for joining us.